I'm going to be talking about the extraordinary life. And today is the first one. Hallelujah. Subtitled, Adopted as Sons and Daughters of the Most High God. Adopted as the sons and daughters of the Most High God. How many of us came to church with our writing materials? You are here with your notebook and your diary or something you're using to write and a pen. Let me see your hands if you have your pen, your notebooks, your diary. Let me see your hands now. Okay. Sorry, something is wrong. Let me correct this. Hallelujah. The battery? Praise God. All right. Tell your neighbor, write. Tell your neighbor, it's insultive to God. Face your neighbor. Say, neighbor, it's insultive to God when he speaks and you don't take notes. Hallelujah. You know, I want to teach you something. Never be a Christian who goes to church without taking notes. It's a sign of irresponsibility. Say, I'm responsible. Say, I'm a responsible son of God. I can't hear your voices, oh. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, let me tell you something. Last night, the Lord was teaching me something. He said, if you read Psalm 1, he said, put it on the screen for us. This is not in alignment with what I want to share, but I think I'll just run it briefly to bless someone. Psalm 1 verse 1, it says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Verse 2. But his delight is in the law of his God, and in his law he meditates day and night. His delight is in the law of the Lord, okay? He said, it shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. So he was teaching me, he said, can you see the way David constructed that verse? You know, in the Bible days, there was no Bible like this. The Bible was a scroll that was in the custody of the priest. Only the priest had the right to take the scrolls and read them. Even Jesus in his day had to go and take the scroll to say, and all that. So he said those days, the priests were the ones that used to do what? They will read out the word, people will hear them, they will explain to people. He said, that was what he was saying when he said, every ministry has a river. And the river is called the rivers of living water, which is what he said in John 8, verse 37. He says, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living waters. He said, can you see what the enemy does? He said, the enemy tries to make members of local churches. He says, they don't pay attention to the word. Because why? The river is the one that will prosper them. But many don't. It says the river goes out like this through the word of God as being shared. It says the word of God is the conveyor of that river. Go to verse 3. See what he said there. It says, it shall be like a tree. So when we say, it says those who are planted in the house of the Lord. So when you are planted in the house of the Lord, you are meant to be by the river. There's a river in every church. Hallelujah. It says that river is the river of what? It says rivers of what? Not river. Rivers. Rivers. It says that brings forth its fruit. Because why? The moment the person begins to take the word being spoken over his life and takes it and meditates upon it, that person begins to experience fruitfulness. That person begins to experience transformation in every area of their lives. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, this is the key. See, you are in business, you are in anything. The word of God is the key. Every word you hear, take those words and run with them. Hallelujah. You will experience transformation and progress in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, the enemy now makes, he says, go to verse 1. Said the enemy does this. When people don't take the word, they begin to walk in the counsel of unbelievers. They begin to think like unbelievers. They begin to function carnally. They function with their five senses. They begin to walk in paths, not as sinners, but they begin to walk in paths of unbelievers. They begin to function naturally. See that they function, nothing supernatural about them. Hallelujah. And it's not meant to be so. Because why? There's a river that flows. Once the river flows, the river makes everything grow in its time. Hallelujah. Say, I will grow in the name of Jesus Christ. Say, I will grow in the name of Jesus Christ. Say, I will take the word of God seriously. That is very, very important. All right, let's go straight to what I want to share today. I said, adopted as sons and daughters of God. Go to Ephesians 1 verse 5. Ephesians 1 verse 5. It says, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. He said, we have been predestined to be adopted. How many of us know what adoption means? Adoption. Say adoption. It's not Calabar language, it's English. That adoption. Praise God. All right. Adoption, let me define it here. It says, adoption is the legal act of taking the child of another parent to become your own. In so doing, all the rights and responsibilities of the welfare of that child are transferred to the new parents. Do you understand what I said just now? Adoption is the legal process or legal act of taking the child of another parent to become your own. In so doing, all rights and responsibilities for the welfare of that child are transferred to the new parent. Praise the Lord. You know, when you go to orphanages, you see parents, maybe they've been trusting God for children for years and they've not had children. They will go and adopt the child, a child in the orphanage. Right or wrong? All right. So they adopt the children and the children become their own. They sign legal documents that transfers the rights and everything of that child to the new parent. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, this is the natural way of adoption in our world. All over the world, adoption is a legal thing. The Constitution recognizes adoption in every part of the earth. Hallelujah. More so, it is also what is recognized also in the spirit realm, in our kingdom, in the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of spirits. Adoption is a reality too. Hallelujah. That was why he said, before we were born, God had predestined us to be adopted. So, even though your father, your biological parent, gave birth to you, God had predestined you to be adopted sometime in the future. Hallelujah. And the process for that adoption is what we call the born again experience. The born again experience. Hallelujah. So the born again experience is the process which the Supreme Court in the heavens of heavens have approved for adoption. Hallelujah. How do I mean? You were given birth to by your biological parents. But the day you become born again, that day you cease to exist in the eyes of God. You cease to exist as the son or daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Ikiri. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, from the day you got born again, God took over the rights and responsibilities of your welfare. Praise the Lord. Please give God some praise. See, if Dangote comes today and says, I want to adopt you, I see that you have been suffering under this parent. Some of us say, Daddy, you have to go. Daddy, and they go, Dangote. Praise God. You know, praise the Lord. So, you can see, God adopted you and I. The day we became born again, he made us his own. From that day, God became our father and our mother. Praise the Lord. From that day, God took responsibility for your welfare. Hallelujah. I don't know if people are in this church this morning. I said, God has taken over the right to take care of you. Hallelujah. So even if your biological parents cannot afford school fees, go and meet your true parent. Say, Daddy, I want to go to school. They said the school fees is this amount. And see if he will not do it for you. Hallelujah. There was a young man, which I've told it many times. His name is Benjamin. He was our former keyboardist a long time ago. And I asked him, why not in school? He said, there's no money. My parents can't afford. I said, you don't need that. I said, do you want to go to school? He said, yes. I said, then you have it covered. Because God will do it for you. And he was wondering if I was crazy. And I told him, the first thing is that, are you serving God? He said, yes. Are you true? Are you sure? I said, okay, good. I said, go ahead now. Which school do you want to go to? He said, National Open University. I said, now go to that school and ask for the form. I said, before you go, pray to God. Tell God, I want to start university. This is the course I want to do. Get him involved. So he prayed, came to meet me. I laid my hands on him, prayed with him. He went. He got the form. Before we knew what was happening, he got a job. And that job was paying him monthly a large sum of money. And with that money, he was able to buy the form of the school. And he was able to start this. Today, he's in 400 level of National Open. He'll be finishing, I think, this year and all that. Today, his life has changed. He's now a musician. He sings and he plays a keyboard. He does so many things right now. It's total change of story. Why? Because his earthly parents could not afford it. But the one who is in heaven said, I will do it. Hallelujah. So you see, it's not because nobody is disadvantaged. Say, I'm not disadvantaged. Once you are born again, you are not disadvantaged. You cannot be disadvantaged. Hallelujah. That is the essence of this message. Church going is not an activity. Church going is meant to be an encounter for you. Where you hear the word of God like this, take it in, go back home, read through what you have written down, get the audio tape again, hear it again, and apply it to your life. That is what church is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The day I started attending Daystar, I took the word of Pastor Madiemi, I took it as my reality. I ate it like a madman, like a hungry man. I allowed the word to overwhelm me, and the word change my destiny. It will change your own in the name of Jesus Christ. So I want you to take this word seriously. So the born again experience is the adoption process in the spirit realm. The first one I talked about is a natural process. Is that not so? The second one is a spiritual process. So someone will say, but God didn't sign any form for me now. How did God do it? How was I adopted? When did they adopt me? Let me tell you the process of our adoption. It is the process of death, recreation, and resurrection. Hallelujah. With a brand new life. Hey! Please, go to Romans 6 verse 4. Glory be to God. Man kalaba shapanamaya. Hayalamanaya. It says, therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Say, when Jesus died, say it like you mean it. Say, when Jesus died, I died. When he was raised up from the dead, I was raised up with him also. Hallelujah. That is what happened. See, let me tell you what happened. How many of you know that Jesus had to be born again? Do you know he was born again? Do you agree with me? Why do you agree with me? Jesus had to be born again. That's why he is called the sample son. He's called the firstborn. Let me give you an example. Let me just explain that process to you. When he came into this world, there was no sin in him. He was perfect both in his body and in his spirit. He was conceived through a medium of a virgin, a lady called Mary. Hallelujah. And he came into this world, there was no sin. But on the day he was sacrificed, the Bible says the sins of the whole world was laid on Jesus. Sin is a spiritual thing. It was laid on his spirit. And on that day, the Bible says, if you read Habakkuk, it says God is too holy to behold sin. And that was why Jesus was, that was what he was praying about. He was not, he was praying when he said in the Garden of Gethsemane, Father, if it's your will, let it be done, you know, and all that. Because he had never been separated from the Father from eternity. That was going to be the first time he was going to be separated from the Father for the first time. God the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost had been one all from eternity. But on this particular day, because the sin of the whole world was going to be placed on him, one of the Godhead was going to be separated from the Godhead. And that day was the day he sacrificed himself. When he said, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. When he said, my Father, why hast thou forsaken me? Because on that day, the Lord turned his back on Jesus and Satan came. The devil pounced on him on that day. And, you know, they made a mess of Jesus Christ on that day. They beat him. Jesus was naked on the cross, guys. I'm telling you, forget all those things. He was naked. His body was, he was beyond human recognition. They beat him to pulp. His face was mangled. Everything was, you know, he was beaten. And he went down to hell. And when he went down to hell, he spent how many days there? And on the third day, after he had satisfied all the regulations and all that of the spirit world, the Bible says he was begotten again. If you read Psalm 2, go to Psalm 2. Kandalabo Sheke Mahasadaba. Our God is a good God. Woo! Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Psalm 2 verse 7. Psalm 2 verse 7. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. He says, this was why he says, see, he says, I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Hallelujah. That was the day he was born again. He left the realm of death and hell and he came back to life again. Shout hallelujah. Go to Acts 13 verse 32. Acts 13 verse 32. Paul and Peter was narrating this story and he was sharing it. He was sharing the same story also. Glory be to God. Woo, glory. See, it says, and we declare to you glad tidings, that promise which was made to the fathers. Verse 33. God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus, as it is also written in the second Psalm. You are my son. Today have I begotten you. So Jesus was the first born again person that the whole creation ever had. Hallelujah. So you see, he had to be born again. He had to be reclaimed from the place of hell and death. Just like you and I have also been reclaimed. Say thank you, Lord Jesus. All right, let's continue now. So it's a process of death, recreation, and resurrection with a brand new life. Go to 2 Corinthians 5:17. Quickly, 2 Corinthians 5:17. You know, someone say, ah, Jesus born again. I thought he was... He became born again. Glory. He was born again. Hallelujah. You know, that is the love of God. For God to leave heaven, he didn't have to come for any reason. Why would he come? For man. What is man? He came from heaven, took on our sinful nature. He went to hell for our sake, came back alive, and gave us his life. How can we live an ordinary life? I don't understand this. Today we are going to pray. You cannot live ordinary. Nobody here will live ordinary life. I'm telling you. Ah, yeah, yeah. Anyway, let me continue. You see, this year, anyway. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Ah, yeah. See, that's all things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, the question you will ask me, when did I die? When did I resurrect again? Which, well, you see, when you give your life to Christ, when you say, Lord Jesus, today I receive you as my Lord and Savior, a spirit, this process of death, recreation, and resurrection happens like this. Because why? There is no time in the spirit realm. Do you get it now? People are used to time. So they're thinking that maybe we just die now. We will die. After 5 minutes, the God will create us again, and then it will lift us up. No, it's a spiritual thing. You are a spirit. You are living in a body. Do you get it now? You say, I'm a spirit being. See, you are living in a body. This whole thing happens within the twinkling of an eye. You die, you were recreated, and you were resurrected with the divine life of God. That is what happens during this process of what? Of adoption. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go to Titus. Titus 2 verse 5. Titus 2 verse 3 verse 5. Titus 3 verse 5. It says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration. We were regenerated. See, you see, the word re means it was re. Born again means you were born before. Do you get it? Now you are born a second time. You were born naturally and ordinary. You were reborn extraordinary and supernatural from a supernatural God. Hallelujah. See, this is a process that happened by the Spirit of the living God. So you were born naturally and ordinary through your biological parents. But when you were born again, you were reborn supernaturally and extraordinary. That's why you cannot afford to live a natural life again. When we say extraordinary, it means there's something beyond ordinary. Do you get it now? When we say supernatural, there is super, there's natural. To be natural means you are under the elements of this world. But to be super means you are above and beyond. That's why it says the Greek meaning of the word born again is to be born from above. See, the problem of many Christians is identity. Many don't know who they are. And if you don't know who you are, you'll be rubbish anywhere you are. That will not be your testimony in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. You now have the same life Jesus has. The same life he was recreated with. That is the life you were recreated with. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. What is this life called? It is called eternal life. I asked someone whom I thought would know this. I said, what is eternal life? She said, living forever. I said, oh, now I see the massive ignorance out there. This is what the devil doesn't want people of God to understand. People think eternal life, everlasting life, is living forever because of the construction of the English language, everlasting life. See, every human being in this world will live forever, whether you are born again or not. Whether spirits don't die. Hallelujah. The way we call death in this realm is not the way to look at death in that realm. Death in that realm is separation from God, because God is life. And when God is not in you, you are dead. But in this world, we say someone has died because his flesh died. Do you get that? Because his flesh died. We say, no. Spirits don't die. Are you following me? So now I asked, I said, what is it? He said, living forever. I said, no. I said, let me change your theology. So I showed her. Go to 1 John 3, verse 15. 1 John 3, verse 15. Oh, glory be to God. You are going to enjoy this. You're going to, oh my goodness. Hallelujah. It says, whoever hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has what? Eternal life where? Abiding where? In him. So where did they get that eternal life is living forever? It is a life that is inside you. Say, I have the life of God in me. Say, I have the life of God in me. You see, many say this, but it has not registered on their being yet. Because you are still wondering, you are saying it sounds good. But the day it registers on the inside of you, that day you will lay hands on the wall. You will lay hands on the fan. You will lay hands on things not working. And you will see them work for you. I'm telling you. Yesterday, I was sharing with Jeffrey in the car. I said, don't think that way, guy. Think differently. You can get this for free. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. You have the life of God in you. Jesus needed a donkey. He said, go and buy one for me. It's a brand new car. Go and get it for me. Because why? He is in charge. Once you have that life, you are in charge. Hallelujah. When you have the life of God, you reign in life as a king. Nothing in this world of natural things can overwhelm you. Glory be to God.
That is the life we've been given. This is a message to church, which the devil doesn't want the church to preach, because he knows when people begin to realize who they are, that they have the same life with Jesus. When you have the same life, I always use this testimony, this story. I say, put my life in a dog. How will that dog behave amongst other dogs? That dog ceases to function as an ordinary dog. It begins to function like me. Because why? That dog has my life. The dog can now function at a higher level than his other dogs. He may have the shape of a dog, but in action and in productivity and fruitfulness, is different. Because why? He has a higher level of functioning. So that's my testimony. Another example, go to 1 John 5 verse 11. 1 John 5 11. Quickly, he says, and this is the testimony that God has given us what? Eternal life. And this life is where? It's in his Son. So you see, that life is not living forever. It's a life. Hallelujah. We have animal life. We have plant life. We have human life. And the highest is the God life, which is the what? Eternal life. You cannot have eternal life and be functioning at the same level with somebody with the human life. Where did you get it from? What did Jesus die for? Why did he go naked on the cross? Why did they beat him if we have to end up functioning as an ordinary human being in this world? Hallelujah. Why can we function and be thinking like ordinary men? We are not ordinary. Hallelujah. We are not ordinary. When you have this life, you don't function under the systems of this world any longer. You function under the system of the heavenlies. Hallelujah. Man has a role to play in the realm of the spirit. Hear this. The spirit realm is for spirits. Man is a spirit. We have a role there. Glory be to God. The spirit world cannot dictate to us. We dictate to devils what they do. We tell angels where to go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because we are the next in hierarchy to God Almighty. Hallelujah. In fact, today, amongst the Godhead is a man. Jesus, he took off his deity, became a man, took up sin, went to hell, was born again, and he was given the glorified status of a man. Hallelujah. Can you see that? So, you and I don't have any excuse not to dominate this world, not to reign in life as a king. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah.